Welcome back to Let's Code. I'm Chris Biscardi, and today we're going to go over how to implement the builder pattern. If you're unfamiliar with the builder pattern in Rust, yesterday I did a video, which I'll link in the description, that explains what the builder pattern is. It's a light introduction, so go check that out. Today, though, we are implementing the builder pattern for your own personal structs and types. So on the right-hand side here, I've got a terminal, and I just ran this application, which I can prove to you by running it again. And what we end up with here is the output for like a blog post template. There's a slug, there's some front matter, there's some tags, and there's a title, and then there's some content of the blog post or whatnot. I chose a blog post because it seemed like one of the more universally understood things, and you can now take this code and kind of extend it with your own version of what a blog post should have. So you get to take this code and kind of go play around with it. On the left-hand side here, let's take a look at the usage of the builder pattern that we've implemented. So I've left out any extra like if statements or whatever, but basically we've got this blog post type and we create a new blog post using some title, and that gives us back this post. And if we bring up the types, we can see that that's actually a template, and that's pretty critical for us. So builder APIs, like if we have a blog post, usually when you do new to start off or kick off a builder API chain, it returns you a different struct. Now, if you are feeling blah, you can just name this like blog post builder or something like that. But very often people try to choose more descriptive names for these. So in this case, I've chosen template because we're kind of building up a template. You can see that we've got a couple of functions here. We've got .tag for adding tags to our blog post. We've got .slug for setting the slug. And when we're done, we just call post. And when we're done, we call the post function, which accepts the actual like blog post content and returns us a fully formed blog post struct. I've also implemented some functions that expose the blog post contents. So in this case, I've done as file, which gives us this layout on the right here using Serde. Or one of the things that I think is interesting here is that if we do final post dot, none of the fields for the blog post come up because they're all private, but somehow we've still constructed one. So if I try to do like final post dot title, title just doesn't exist. And you can see field title of struct blog post is private. So we're not allowed to access it outside of the module. And this is kind of one of the benefits of a builder API. So if we look at the blog post, we can see that the front matter is a B-tree map. We'll talk about what a B-tree map is in a second. Title, slug, tags, which is a B-tree set, same thing. And then body, which is a string. Now, if you don't have a title or a slug specifically, then your blog post can't be placed somewhere on like a website, right? So in our case, we're going to treat the title as being required. You have to pass in a title to actually be able to start constructing a blog post. That's a required field. Actually, both of these are required. So if we look at the new function that is implemented on blog post, new takes the title, and it'll slugify the title for us. So we get a title and a slug, and we know we have those. And then we set default values that work for the metadata and the tags list, as well as the body, which we just set to none. Now, the body specifically could be like an empty string or something, but I chose not to go to that direction. And this new function, again, returns a template. So we've got the blog post struct up here, and then we have the template down here, which you could also refer to as like a blog post builder. And you'll see that the template here has slightly different fields. So instead of having something called front matter, we have meta, we have title and slug, which are required, which we will have when we initialize this struct. We have tags and meta, which contain arbitrary Serde JSON values. If you're unfamiliar with Serde and Serde JSON, a Serde JSON value is just like any JSON value. So it's like an array, an object, a string, etc. And then body is optional. If we look at the blog post above, body is not optional. So this is also one of the benefits of having a builder API. In our case, we use the finalizer, the post function, to make sure that if we're going to give you a blog post, you gave us both a title and the content. Everything in here, the tags, changing the slug, that's all optional. You can choose to do that. You cannot do that. It doesn't matter. So what we're really doing here is bouncing back and forth between two types. We use the blog post type and the new function that we've implemented on it to sort of kick off the builder with our required set of fields, like the things that we know we absolutely need that we don't want to provide later. And that returns us a template. A template often has more optional types inside of it, or more things with default empty values and things like that. Because what we're trying to do is keep this flexible type that we can build up over time with optional arguments that we can then catalyze into something that is a little bit stricter and a little bit more ready. It's like finalized, right? Something we can send as our HTTP request, or something that we can directly write out to the file as the blog post, or execute as a process like we explored in the last video. Which brings us to the set of functions that represent all of the optional functions that we can call, all of the optional fields that we can set. And this is the core of the Builder API. What it comes down to is that the functions that we want to offer for people to set additional configuration on our builder type will accept a mutable reference to themselves. So in this case, we have template. We're doing impl template here. And a mutable self reference means we get a mutable reference on self to template. And then when we're done here, and we've done whatever we want to do, in this case, we're setting a slug, so we also accept a string. That string gets slugified just in case you didn't do a good enough job as the user. We're going to help you out with that. So it gives us a little bit of extra safety, a little bit of extra user leeway. So they can pass in really whatever they want. They could pass in, you know, like a space filled capital letter, whatever, and we'll lowercase it and hyphenate it for them. So we've encapsulated that kind of like checking logic, or it's not really validation. It's making sure that the values that we're taking in, that we're going to set in our struct, are values that are valid, that are processed the way that we want them. And this slug function, it's taking a mutable self-reference and it's returning a mutable reference to a template. And this is the key. It's accepting that mutable reference and returning that mutable reference. So it does what it needs to, and then it returns the reference. And this is the thing that allows us to chain these together. So we've got a template up here because that was the new function. And if we set a variable here, which I'm not going to do, you would see that Y gets a mutable reference to template, which means that anytime we're calling tag, this returns a mutable reference to the template, which we can then call tag on again because we have this function implemented on template that accepts a mutable self-reference. And we can either chop that up into multiple places. So for example, we have it tagging Rust twice, just as a example for what happens if we set multiple values here. And then we same thing for slug. So we've got tag, we've got property, which allows us to set an arbitrary property. And then finally we get post, and post returns a blog post. So it doesn't really matter what we take in as the argument here. I think this would all, the reason I'm doing mute here, mute self, is that we do self.body equals something, and then we do self into, which turns it into a blog post and returns the blog post for us. Now we are doing additional processing here. So this is also very important. When we finalize this, we take the blog post in and we set the blog post on, in this case, the template, and then we call into. Into is a function that is given to us for free when we implement from for two types. So this isn't necessarily builder related. You could just throw this code into that function and it would work just fine. But if you have a template, you can turn it into a blog post using this implementation. So in this from function, we get the template. We set up the front matter with the meta variable. Again, this is a B-tree map with keys that are strings and values that are strata.json values. And we can just insert all of the other values that haven't been set in that front matter yet. So we've got slug, title, and tags, which are pretty base level fields in our struct here, right? In our template struct. But we want those to be in the front matter, even if we haven't added any other properties. We always want the slug, the title, and the tags to match in that front matter between the ones that we set and the ones that we're going to kind of export. So inside of the from function, we set all of these values in the B-tree map. We turn the tags, which are a B-tree set, first into a vec of strings and then into a strata.json array of strings. And we return the blog post. In this case, from can't fail. So if you have a template and for some reason you really just don't want to give it a blog post, you can just use this from implementation and you'll get an empty blog post body. And that's fundamentally it, right? So the builder pattern is you have some type that requires some configuration before you can use it, right? Before you can send that HTTP request or run that process or something like that. We can construct a builder type, so in this case template, that has more optional fields, that has a more flexible data model. And then we can offer functions to interact with that data model on a gradual level, on a discrete level. And we can just keep calling these all over the place whenever we want them. We can do really advanced configuration, like setting up a blog post and then calling a bunch of different stuff. We could have a bunch of if statements here. We could be doing all sorts of things. And then we finalize. But it also supports very simple configuration. So if I comment all of that out and then I save this, this is the one-liner version. And this is no longer called final post. So if I save that and run this, then what we get is the title, the tags, the slug, and the post body, right? So it works for very one-linery kinds of things. And it also works for very complicated setups where there's a lot of work that you need to do to get that configuration to whatever you need it to be. So there are a couple tests here. If you've never seen tests before, these are organized into a submodule. Submodules in Rust do not need to be in a different file because the module paths are not related to the file system. So in this tests submodule, which is a completely arbitrary name, we use all of the functions that we offer from the parent module. In this case, it's everything in this source file, the blog post type, the template type, all that stuff. We use the test macro to define a test. Tests in Rust are regular functions. And we see the one-liner version of the blog post here, where we do blog post new and then immediately post, and we get a blog post out of it. And you can see how much extra code we're kind of getting rid of here. So if we were going to construct this blog post ourselves, if we were going to set all the values that come with that blog post without this builder API, we would be doing blog post with the title. We would have to set all the front matter ourselves. So that's three values. We'd have to set up the tags. We'd have to set up the slug, and we'd have to set up the body, and we'd have to do it all at the same time. So we've actually turned this into, we'll call this four lines. It's really two lines, but we'll call it four for now. We've turned it four lines, and then this is, I don't know, 137, 116, 20 lines. So we've turned a 20 line configuration into two lines by using this builder pattern. Now, you don't always want to do this, but it can be nice. The reason we can do assert equals here on blog post is because right at the top, we derive partial equality. We've got two other tests. We've got a two front matter test to test the front matter generation. And we've got a two file test to test the file generation with the blog post and the front matter, which brings us back to the blog post impl. So the same place that we defined new that gave us that template starter that we can just keep adding to. We defined a couple of functions that are useful once we actually do have a fully constructed blog post. So we can construct the blog post and then just get back the front matter, or get back the front matter and the blog post content as full file templated out. And this is using Serde YAML for doing toString on the front matter, and then format with a arbitrary front matter separator. So in this case, I used three dashes. And that's the same thing that we use in the main.rs as well. So we've got final post as file, and that gives us the whole file. And again, it's just kind of nice to work with, right? Because you've got this couple liner for building up this blog post. You can do it simply like this or in a complicated way like this. And it allows you to restrict access to the inner fields of the blog post to make sure that the thing that you're configuring is being built up in a more complicated way than the user experience that you want to offer will let you do. So we get this really nice, like, blog post new, use whatever functions we want to, finalize it with post API, rather than setting up all of these fields ourselves and then handling everything ourselves. So that's the builder pattern. I'll leave the link to this repo in the description. I will once again say that the key to the builder pattern is this kind of model of accepting mutable references and returning mutable references to the builder type. But obviously, nothing is set in stone. You don't have to do this. You also don't have to do it this way. A different kind of approach works for you. If it works for you to not accept a mutable reference in some cases, then you should do that. Of course, you won't be able to kind of chain that together if you do that. But there are completely valid reasons to, for example, do different things. So feel free to play around with this. The code is going to be in the description, like I said. So if you want to add some fields, if you want to play around with the code here and see how it works, if you say, for example, want to add a tag up here, I'll just type some random letters. You'll see some errors that you can kind of play around with. In this case, it's going to be a temporary value is freed issue because dot tag is returning a mutable reference, but the template that we created with the blog post new function isn't being stored anywhere. So that's why you get that particular error. But I encourage you to play around with it, see what errors you can find, see if you can fix them. And I will see you in the next video. And if you have any questions, leave them in the comments and I'll be sure to get back to them. Have a great day.